Dear colleagues, my name is Vladimir Ciric and I am with University of Niš Faculty of Electronic Engineering. The topic of my today's talk is the concept of consumer IP address preservation behind the load balancer. This is a joint work of me and my colleagues Nikola Vidojkovic, Nađa Gavrilović and even Milentijevic, who are also with Faculty of Electronic Engineering. I will start my today's talk with motivation, and after that I will briefly discuss proxy servers and load balancing along with the proxy protocol and the spoofing of IP address. Then I will present the concept of consumer IP address preservation behind the load balancer. I will conclude my talk with implementation and evaluation results. About the motivation, we are all aware that number of internet hosts are growing every day. And with a large number of hosts and users overall, the security becomes a great challenge. So additional security architectures should be adapted to networks, and they usually rely on packet filtering, proxy technologies, and intrusion detection systems. Having a complex and robust security architecture on the network perimeters usually interferes with some basic features of the services, and the first feature which is usually lost is transparency. What is actually transparency? When a packet from a client travels through the server, and when it passes through robust security architecture, usually the original IP address of the packet is lost. So the server does not know which actual client is communicating with him. So some features that relies on the original IP address can be lost, and these features are usually features related to authentication of the client and features related to geolocation of the client. So let me briefly discuss how load balancing works. So we have a load balancer who serves multiple servers and balance the load between those servers. So when the client requests access to the server, the service, it requests for IP address from the DNS server, and it usually gets the IP address of the load balancer. So the client sees the service through the IP address. Then the client sends one packet with the request for the service, which has the source IP address of the client itself, and the destination in that packet is the destination is the address of the load balancer. Then load balancer makes a decision to which server to forward the traffic based on the load, and there are different strategies. One strategy is simple round robin, the second strategy is based on least connections to the server, then based on the load on the server, etc., etc. And let us consider that load balancer makes a decision to forward the packet to the first server. So it forwards the packet, and in the source IP address of the packet, we have the IP address of the load balancer. The destination IP address is actual IP address of the destination server. And here where the problem actually lies. The problem lies here that the destination server will not know from the packet header the IP address of the actual client with which he is communicating with. So he will receive the request from the load balancer, and he will reply to that request to the load balancer as well. So the reply will have IP address of the actual destination server, and which serves the request, and the destination IP address of the request will be the proxy who actually asked for the service. The proxy will forward the request back to the client. So the client in this case doesn't know the IP address of actual server, and the server More importantly, does not know the IP address of the client. If the authentication on the server is based on the IP address of the client, then that feature is lost for sure. So in order to avoid that problem, different protocols deals with the problem in different manners. For example, HTTP protocol defines the forwarded extension, which can contain the IP address of the actual client. Within this field, within the protocol itself, the IP address of the client can be forwarded from the proxy to the server. SMTP, for example, has its own extension and it is called X-Client. In similar manner, it can embed IP address to some protocol header and send it to the client. The drawback here is that each application layer protocol needs to be aware of the problem and needs to handle the problem itself. So, to avoid that problem, each proxy proposed few years ago, the proxy protocol, which is meant to standardize that communication and in the standard manner send the client's IP address to the server. Let's consider that scenario. So we have here H proxy, which implements the proxy protocol. So in the first step, the client contacts H proxy and he knows how to do that because he obtained the IP address of the service, which is seen through the proxy, through DNS system. This is the first step in the communication, and from the source IP address, actual source IP address, we are contacting the IP address of the proxy. Then the proxy prepares a special header within the definition as defined in the proxy protocol and forwards the special request to the server, sending him IP address of the client. It is this IP address within the frame of the proxy protocol. And after that, on the same port of the server, it continues the communication, forwarding, like in the previous case, from the IP address of the proxy, it forwards to the IP address of actual server. Then the server, if the server is proxy protocol capable, then the server will fill its internal forms with the information which he learns from the proxy protocol. If the server is not proxy protocol capable, then the server will not fill that information. The source IP address will be lost. The information about source IP address will be lost. But important point here is that they tested and they reported that neither of well-known protocols have a drawback of stalling if not recognize the PP header. So usually, for example, if it is web server who is not PP capable, the web server will reply to the proxy protocol header with bad request, but it will continue with the communication further on. So it will reply to the proxy having destination address of the server in the source of that packet, and it is destined for the proxy who will forward the packet to actual client. So in order to relax the server from being proxy protocol capable or not, IP spoofer who is proxy protocol capable can be embedded between a proxy and the server. So the communication can be modified to look like this. The client, as in the previous case, contacts a proxy, sending from his source address to the address of the proxy server. Then the proxy sends to IP spoofer who is proxy protocol capable two packets. First packet is with proxy protocol header containing actual source address, and the second packet is IP packet from proxy to the spoofer. And then is the key point when the spoofer spoofs the source address and sends the packet with spoofed source address. He writes here the actual source address of the client, not his own, and sends it to the server, server's IP address. Here, you should notice that the IP address that server sees is the actual address of the client. So server, from the server perspective, he is communicating with actual client and all features can be retained. So the tricky part is when the server responds. When the server responds, he responds from his own IP address, but the destination address in his response is the IP address of the client. And that cannot be true, that cannot work, because the client is on different network, the communication is spoofed in between. So in order to maintain the communication, spoofer should intercept that communication. And regardless that the packet is not designated for the IP spoofer, it is for the client, spoofer should intercept the packet, exchange the destination address again, and send it on its way back, and the IP address, source IP address here, the IP address of the spoofer, and it sends it all along the way through the edge proxy, which forwards it back to the client. On this way, we preserved a source IP address, but the drawback is that we require here advanced routing between the server and IP spoofer. And this is the architecture that we proposed in our paper. That architecture contains of two containers. The first container is the container with load balancer, which is which is actually the service provider for the client. So when the client requests the service, it will obtain the IP address of the container. In our case, the first container has two interfaces. One is interface container 1-1 and the other is interface container 1-2. These are two IP addresses, and the second container who has one IP address. The first container, I should notice that it is equipped with intrusion detection system, which logs intrusions. And in the second container, we put IP spoofer along with the server. We put them together because we wanted to use Linux IP tables tool and its capability to route every communication through loopback interface of the container itself. This is a loopback interface, so all communication from the spoofer to the container and from the server back again is done through loopback interface. The configuration of IP tables is given in the paper, so if you are interested in seeing how the IP tables actually are configured, you can refer to the paper. So the communication begins with client contacting the service seen through the IP address of the first container. It contacts load balancer. Load balancer is proxy protocol capable, so this was the first packet, the same as in the previous case. The second packet is the packet with proxy protocol header in which load balancer sends IP address of actual client to IP spoofer. And the third packet is the connection which is made with actual request from load balancer to IP spoofer. IP spoofer spoofs the address and forwards it to server through loopback interface. And the server replies two loopback interface, which is intercepted by IP tables and forwarded to IP spoofer. Again, configuration of IP tables is given in the paper. IP spoofer replays back to the load balancer, which eventually sends the response back to the client. This architecture is simplified and contains only two containers. The second container can be multiplicated, and we have multiple containers, the same as LXC container 2, which then fully utilizes the load balancer given in the first container. We implemented the architecture on the server with characteristics shown here. For the operating system, we used Debian 9 with Proxmox virtual environment. At the container level, we used CentOS 7.6. For the server, we implemented Apache Web Server 2.4.6, and we used Snort ID intrusion detection system version 2.9.12. For the sake of evaluation, we used publicly available web page test, and we measured several different responses. We measured DNS response, we measured initial connection time, we measured first byte time, and we measured total transfer time. This slide shows the results. The A stands for our architecture, and the B stands for the architecture without any additional security perimeter. So B is for direct client-server communication without load balancing, without IP spoofer, and without IP tables. So we measured responses for different page sizes, for different number of requests within the page, and the main conclusion is that the response time is not significantly different in those two cases. And to conclude, at the end, in this paper we showed the concept of advanced routing and network address translation, which preserves the original consumer IP address while consumer is accessing the service through load balancer. The concept and routing techniques are described in detail, and we showed the results of the implementation. The results show that no significant time overhead was introduced, introducing a robust security architecture on the network perimeter. And on the end, we received two questions from the committee, and I will take an opportunity to answer to those questions. First question was, can you comment on the proposed approach versus the utilization of the elastic cloud solutions overall? So about utilization of the elastic solution, I can say that approach proposed in this paper can be utilized in Elastic Cloud, but with drawback that the IP spoofer should be kept really near to the services, and it can be replicated and multiplicated as many times as you want, as I showed in the container 2, in order to enable elastic feature. And the second question was, can this solution be integrated within a platform as a service, and how? In the same manner, the server can be replaced with any platform as a service solution, and the IP addresses can be spoofed using advanced routing and IP tables as shown. And with this, I will conclude my presentation. I want to thank you for your attention. Thank you. Bye.